Good evening.
Good evening.
It's nice to see each of you here this evening. How many of you have been enjoying what you've been hearing so far? Okay. Well, and I wanted to let you know that I've talked with Elder Skeet, and he has indicated that he was willing to share with us this coming Saturday night also. So instead of just two more times, he's going to be here tomorrow night, Saturday morning at 11 o'clock, and then Saturday evening at 7. We're taking advantage of every single moment that we can have with him until his flight leaves at 12 o'clock noon on Sunday. I thought about having a 5 o'clock early morning Sunday service, but I thought maybe that might be pressing my luck a little bit. So, you know, God is so amazing in what he does, and it is a delight to see each of you here this evening. Let us bow our heads. Our Father in heaven, we ask for your presence here tonight. Not demanding, but supplicating, seeking your will, asking for your presence. I ask for you to become almost visible as the Word of God is shared this evening, so that we can see you through the words that you have had written in the Scriptures, inspiring men to write these words, so that we may see you. We ask for your blessing on each person that is here. Send your Holy Spirit to work in a powerful way. I ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Out from heaven's palaces, splendor filled and bright, came a king, and he came to bring to the world new life and light. What grace is this that brought my Savior down, that made him leave his glorious throne and crown? The one who made the earth, the sky, and seas, who put the stars in every galaxy. What condescension, oh, how can it be? What shame he suffered, oh, what agony. And then the death he died, for sinners crucified. What grace is this? What grace is this? Oh, the boundless grace of God seen in Christ the Lord, greater than all the sins of men, and it's freely now outpoured. What grace is this that brought our Savior down, that made him leave his glorious throne and crown? The one who made the earth, the sky, and seas, who put the stars in every galaxy. What condescension, oh, how can it be? What pain he suffered, oh, what agony. And then the death he died, for sinners crucified. What grace is this? What grace? Christ were daily kept as we walk life's way. Someday we will our Savior see. What a wondrous happy day. What grace is this that brought my Savior down, that made him leave his glorious throne and crown? The one who made the earth, the sky, and seas, who put the stars in every galaxy. What condescension, oh, how can it be? What pain he suffered, oh, what agony. And then the death he died, for sinners crucified. What grace is this? What grace is this?
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, He shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves and made themselves aprons. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Good evening, everyone.
Amen.
How was your day? It was all right? You're not too sure. Well, whatever kind of day you had or I had, we're grateful to God that we can be here in his house. Can you say amen?
Amen.
There are parts of the world where you cannot assemble this way to worship the God of heaven and earth. You just cannot do it. And so we thank God for the privilege of freedom of worship that is still a privilege in this blessed country. I'm glad to see you. I always am. And I pray that the Lord will so possess me. You know, there are two ways to be possessed, by the devil or by God. I want to be Holy Spirit possessed. Are you following me?
Amen.
Not demon possessed. Holy, you see, demon possessed people have no control.
Yes.
Holy Spirit possessed people have given up control.
Amen.
Are you not with
yes.
me? A demon possessed person has no control. A Holy Spirit possessed person has given up control to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So whatever you say, that's what I do. And so I want to be Holy Spirit possessed. He is the Spirit of truth. And I want him to speak through me, that what I say may bless your lives. Because your Father in heaven loves you very much. He loves you very personally. He really does. He loves you intimately. And he sent Christ to die for you. God bless the person next to you, but he sent Christ to die for you. This is very clear from the parable of the lost sheep. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? The shepherd goes looking for the lost sheep. He does not bring the 99 with him. He goes looking for the sheep. It is just the sheep and the shepherd. Salvation, as I have told you before, is a personal matter. It is not a tribal matter. It is not a matter of family tradition. It is an individual matter. And very often, it requires individuals to make decisions that go contrary to the rest of the family. And it takes courage to do that. But Jesus Christ can understand you if you're in that position, because the Bible tells us in John chapter 7, verse 5, neither did his brethren believe in him. There was a time in the life of Christ when the family, as astonishing as it may sound, did not believe in him. And so if you're in that predicament, Jesus understands. When the angel Gabriel told Zacharias to call his son John, when the baby was born in Luke 1:59, all the neighbors, all the friends, on the eighth day, I should say, they came to circumcise him, and they decided to call him Zacharias, after the name of his father. Elizabeth said, no, his name is John. The family said to her, there is no one in this family that is called by that name. This is not a family tradition. That's the argument they use. This is not a tribal tradition. This is not a cultural tradition. She said, her point was, God said John. Amen. And regardless of what the family tradition may be, God said John. Yes. And we need courage to stand against family, friends, society, countries, governments, whenever we find ourselves standing on, thus saith the Lord. What other people think is not important. We ought to obey God, finish the verse for me, rather than man. I didn't mean to preach twice, but that was on my mind, I suppose. Is there anyone with us tonight, for the first time, you are not a Seventh-day Adventist? May I see your hand? Can I start to the left? Good evening. How are you? What's your name?
Lynette.
Mm-hmm. What's the last name?
Holland.
Holland. How are you, Sister Lynette?
I'm fine.
Nice to see you. Thank you very much for coming. God bless you for coming, and God bless whoever invited you. Can you tell us who that person is?
Pastor.
Pastor, you're a busy man. God bless you. Okay. Lynette, thank you for coming. God bless you in every possible way.
Amen.
My brother, I saw your hand. What's your name?
Mark Dixon.
Mark Dixon. Mark is a good Bible name. Mark, where are you from?
Dillon.
Where?
Delphine.
Where's that? That way?
15 minutes.
That way. All right, okay. God bless everybody that way. Thank you, Mark, for coming. God bless you. And God provide your needs in such abundance that you can be a blessing to somebody else. Did I see another hand beside Mark? Did I? Where? What's your name?
Ray
Hathaway. Who?
Lori.
Lori. Hello, Lori. Where are you from?
Stillpond.
That way. Okay, all right. Well, it's nice to have you, Lori. God bless you, bless you, bless you. And may the God's blessing be like a rain shower in your life that soaks you to your spiritual skin. Thank you for coming. God bless you. Did I see another hand? Yes, sister. Are you threatening to raise your hand or are you raising it? All right. What's your name?
Jennifer,
how are you, Jennifer?
Good
to see you. Where are you from?
Chestertown.
Okay, that's where I'm from, Chestertown, right here. Jennifer, God bless you. Thank you very much for coming. And for all of you, God bless whoever invited you. May the Lord place his hand of mercy upon you, Jennifer, and keep it on you until he guides you into his kingdom. Did I see your hand? What's your name?
I'm Donna.
Donna. Hello, Donna. How are you? Where are you from?
I'm from that way.
You're from that way and this way. Okay. Thanks for coming, Donna. Who invited you?
David.
Ah, yes, that's a good man, Dr. David. All right, Donna, may the Lord bless you and grant you the desires of your heart, whatever they may be. Say amen for all our guests.
Amen.
Come on, say it again.
Amen.
One more time.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Yes, yes, I like God. I really do. He's a nice person.
Amen.
And I find no fault with God. You know, Jesus said, they hated me without a cause. Which means, There is never a legitimate reason to be angry with God. Never. Now, we get angry all the time because we suffer from temporary insanity, but there is never a legitimate reason, come on, to get angry with God. Jesus said, they hated me, come on, without a cause. Bible says of God, the Lord is righteous in all his ways. How can you be angry with a God who is always right? But we're finite, we're human, we're dust, and God understands. Psalm 103, verse 14, for he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we are dust, and dust acts crazy from time to time. Our subject for this evening, wonderful power. What did I say?
Wonderful.
Wonderful power. Before I jump into the message, it's already 7:15. I'll release you before 8 o'clock. Please, if you have one of these, make sure it's turned off. If you're using it as your Bible, that's fine, but you don't need sound. And the reason for this request, we must preserve reverence in the presence of a holy God. Are you following me?
Amen.
And God will appreciate that. And when God is happy, he blesses, he blesses, he blesses. Let's keep God happy by reverencing his holy name tonight. Favor number two, while I'm speaking, pray for me and say, Lord, put your words in that man's mouth. I really mean that. From time to time, in the privacy of your heart, simply say, Father, put your words in that man's mouth. That request is based on Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. And that's what I want God to do for me tonight. It is a serious responsibility to speak for God. And if you ever have to do that, make sure you're saying, thus saith the Lord. Anything else is an insult to God, who is the God of truth. The Holy Spirit is called truth. The Son is called truth. God loves truth. Favor number three, think as you listen. Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us do what? Reason together, saith the Lord. I've told you before, God is a reasonable God. The devil is not. Satan is unreasonable, but God is very reasonable. When Cain killed Abel, he came down. Where is your brother? When there was a catastrophe in the Garden of Eden, he came down. Adam, where are you? Eve, what did you do? God, he knows all these things, but he invited, talk to me. Talk to me, says God. I'll listen. I love that about God. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for sparing our lives today, for bringing us to this house of worship. And the center and focus of our worship is you. If we've sinned against you, Father, forgive us and grant to us a greater degree of hatred for sin and an endless love for righteousness. Father, I humble myself before you. And I ask you in the name of Jesus Christ to possess me completely. Every apparatus required to deliver this message, you possess it, dear God. Let me be merely an instrument in your hand. I offer no resistance. Tell me what to say, when to say it, how to say it. Bless those listening, I pray. Grant them comprehension that the Word of God may do its work in the lives of those listening in person and those online. Dear God, if anyone listening to me has contracted COVID-19, I'm appealing to you in the name of Jesus. Heal those persons, Father, 100%, because you're a merciful God. Not only those who believe in you, I also ask you to heal the unbelievers, because your word says, he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good. So, Father, spread your mercy over the sick. We thank you for the guests who are among us. I ask you, Father, very directly, bless them, dear God. Let them know they have been blessed by the God of heaven and earth. Now, dear God, use me, I pray, please. In Jesus' name, amen. Genesis chapter 1, let's read verse 26. Our subject, wonderful power. Genesis, Sister Mary, nice to see you. I have missed you. Nice to see you. All right, what book did I say?
Genesis chapter 1.
Genesis chapter 1, we read verse 26. It's a very familiar verse, you know it very well. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
And God said, let us make man, how?
In
our image, after our likeness, stop. And God said, let us make man in our image. In order to understand what that means, we need to understand what is the image of God in which mankind was made. I refer, of course, to Adam and also to Eve. Let us go to Deuteronomy chapter 32. We read the last part of verse 4 of Deuteronomy 32.
Amen.
All right, good brother, you're quick tonight. Okay. The rest of you, have you caught up with my good brother? Deuteronomy 32, verse 4, the last part of that verse. The Bible refers to God as a God of truth and without what? Iniquity. Finish the verse. Just and right is He. He is a God without iniquity. What kind of God is He? He's perfect. Give me another word.
Righteous.
He's righteous. Give me another word. Listen, He is a God of truth and without iniquity. What kind of God is He? Perfect. Sinless is the word I wanted. But all the other four words are fine, but I wanted sinless. A God of truth and without iniquity. That's God. Let us go to John chapter 14. Let's read verse 30 of John 14. John is a beautiful book. Read it sometime. Beautiful book. Beautiful. You have John 14, verse 30. Read with me. Hereafter I will not walk. Talk with you, for the prince of this world cometh, finish the verse, and hath nothing in me. What does he mean by he has nothing in me? What is it Satan could not find in Christ? What was it Satan could not find in Christ? Sin. Now, go to John 10:30. John chapter 10, verse 30, our subject, wonderful power. It's 20 after 7. I'll release you before 8, or 8, most likely before 8. Not 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, 8 p.m. That's a private joke for those of you who look confused. All right, John chapter 10, let's read verse 30, very short verse. Well, not very short, but what does that say? I and my Father are one. We're the same thing in character, not one person. In character, in mind, in disposition. I and my Father are one. Now, which means if the Father is sinless, how can we describe the Son?
Sinless.
Perfect. Let's go to 1 John chapter 3. Our subject, wonderful power. We need to understand what is meant by let us make man in our image. 1 John chapter 3, we read 4 and 5. It's towards the back of the Bible. Find Revelation, Revelation, Jude, 3rd John, 2nd John, 1st John. Do you have that now? Read with me. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. Come on. For sin is the transgression of the law. Now read verse 5 nice and clear. And ye know that he was manifested to do what? Take away our sin, and in him, come on, is no sin. Now, we're talking about a sinless God. Go to Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2. The weeping prophet. No matter how he preached, nobody listened. And they paid a terrible price. It's a dangerous thing not to listen to thus saith the Lord. Amen. Jeremiah 2 verse 5. Are you there?
Amen.
Read with me. What?
Thus
saith the Lord, yes, what?
What
iniquity have your fathers found in me? God is saying, what have I done wrong? Can your fathers point to anything that I have ever done wrong? What iniquity have your fathers found in me? Go to Micah chapter 6. Micah 6, let's read verse 3, I think it is. Do you have that?
Amen.
Read with me, what does that say? Oh, my people, come on. What have I done to thee, and wherein have I wearied thee? Read carefully now. Testify, take me to court. Sue me, says God. see if you win that case. I have never, ever done you anything wrong. We're establishing the fact that God is sinless and perfect. Now, we go back to Genesis 1:26. There's no need to go, you know it. What does it say? And God said, let us make man how? Stop. Let us make man how? Let us make man how? Sinless. Just the way we are. Mm-hmm. Just the way we are. Now, we know sin entered the world. We know that. Let's go to Genesis 5. Let's read verse 3. Time's flying quickly tonight. It's already 7:25. I'll try to slow it down. Maybe Joshua were here. He could do that. Do you have, where did I send you?
Genesis 5, verse 3.
Let me pray again. Father, as I continue to speak to those whom you love in person and online, tell me exactly what to say. Direct me, control me, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And Adam lived how long? 130 years and begat
a son.
How?
In his own likeness.
In his own likeness, come on, after
his
image. Now, so we have a different image on the earth. We have the one in verse 26 of Genesis 1. And God said, let us make man how? In our image. Now we have a second image. The first image is based on what?
God.
On God's character, sinless. The second one is based on Adam's sinful character. By the way, the sinful character did not begin with Adam. That's why Jesus can say in John 8:44, ye are of your father, the devil. And the lust of your father, the sinful nature, the rebellious mindset against God began with Satan when he rebelled against God long before Adam was made. That's why he was cast out in Revelation 12, verse 9. Let me say it again. The carnal, sinful, rebellious nature which we inherited from Adam did not originate with Adam. It originated with Satan. So Christ can correctly say, ye are of your father, the devil. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 12, let's go there and strengthen that point. 1 John chapter 3, we read 11 and 12. Our subject, wonderful power. You have that, 1 John 3, 11 and 12?
Yes.
Read with me. For this is the message that he heard from the beginning, that what?
That
we should love one another. Listen carefully to 12. Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were righteous, and his brother's, his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. Saint Cain is described as a child of the wicked one. And that's not a reference to Adam, that's a reference to Satan. Go to John 17. Christ is praying to the Father, and the disciples are standing by, listening to him pray. Let's read verse 12 of John 17. I've told you before, tell me slow down when I go too quickly. I tend to do that when I'm excited. Do you have John 17, 12? Read with me. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, finish the verse, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. The son of perdition is a title also given to the Antichrist, who is representative of Satan. Jesus called Judas the son of perdition, a son of the devil, which is a title for the Antichrist in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, also called the man of sin. We have Christ, we have Satan. Now, because of sin, something had to be done to bring us back to the way it was before Adam sinned. Let me say differently. The purpose of the gospel, the purpose of the sacrifice of Christ is not to improve people, it is to transform them. It is to restore in them the image Adam possessed before he sinned. Let me say that again. The purpose of the gospel is to restore by transforming sinners back into the original mold, which was a sinless mold.
Amen.
And so Jesus Christ came and lived a life Adam should have lived. He lived a life the chosen people should have lived. This is the life that God requires, and Jesus Christ lived that life, and he offers that life to us, and that life is a righteous life.
Amen.
Let's take a look at righteousness, because righteousness is power, as verily as sin is power. You see, sin is power to disobey. I didn't say sin is freedom to disobey. There's no freedom in sin. Sin is power to disobey. Righteousness
is power to obey.
Yes! Righteousness is power to obey. You look at me as if you say, give me a Bible verse. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 6. 7:30 on the dot. Deuteronomy 6, we read verse 25. I said, righteousness is power to obey, as verily as sin is power to disobey. But with sin, there's no freedom. With righteousness, there's freedom. Because a sinner cannot leave the devil unless someone comes and gets him.
Amen.
Let me say it slowly. A sinner cannot leave Christ unless someone comes and gets him. Name that person, Jesus Christ, through the Spirit. Someone serving God can leave anytime he wants without anyone coming to get him. That's freedom.
Amen.
What book did I say?
Deuteronomy.
What chapter?
Chapter 6.
What verse? 25. Read carefully, read microscopically, and this shall be our righteousness, if we observe to do what? All these commandments before the Lord our God, as he hath commanded us. Righteousness is conformity to the law of God.
Amen.
This shall be our righteousness. Let me put it differently. The life God required of Adam before he sinned was to be a righteous life. The life required of us after Adam's sin is still to be a righteous life. Now it has to be done through Christ. Before Adam's sin, there was no need for him to live a righteous life. Through Christ, there was more need for that. After sin, humanity became helpless and needed a savior to assist them in living a righteous life. The life of Christ is the life required of Adam before he sinned, required after he sinned, and required of us today. But because we're sinners by birth, but I say that I mean because we're born needing a savior, we need an intercessor, a mediator, someone through whom we can live that righteous life. I said earlier, sin is the power to disobey. Now, sin is a power. Righteousness is a power. Let me say it differently. Sin is a life. It's a twisted life. Righteousness is a straight life.
Amen.
How are we saved?
Through grace.
By grace are you saved through faith, all right? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter 1, we read 18 and 19, our subject, wonderful power. 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. Do you have that? 1 Peter chapter 1, 18 and 19. All right. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. We were redeemed by the precious blood of Christ. And I'm introducing the word blood. We frequently hear Christ shed his blood. What does that mean? Let's go to Revelation chapter 1. Let's read verse 5. Chapter 1, reading verse 5. Our subject, wonderful power. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, read with me now, unto him that loved us and hath washed us, come on, sins in his own blood. He hath washed us from our sins in his own blood. We know from Hebrews 9:22, without shedding of blood, there's no remission. There's no forgiveness without blood. But what are you to understand by blood? Because I said sin is a twisted life, righteousness is a straight life. Go to Genesis 9. This is the chapter in which Noah, they're out of the ark in chapter 8. God gives them instructions in chapter 9 because life on the earth is beginning all over again. And if you read Genesis 9 verse 1, it sounds very similar to what God told Adam before there was a flood, before there was sin. Do you have Genesis 9? Read verse 1 with me. And God did what? Bless Noah and his sons and said unto them what? Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. That's what God told Adam. So Noah is a kind of Adam starting all over again. But this time, they still have the carnal nature. Are you following me? Now, let's go to verse 4 of Genesis 9 as God gives directions regarding diet. He gave directions regarding diet to Adam. Genesis 1:29-30, he gives directions regarding diet to Noah as life is about to begin again. What does verse 4 of Genesis 9 say? But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall he not eat. Now, flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof. You see, the blood is a symbol of the life. Or the blood is a carrier of the life. How do nutrients get to your cells? The blood carries the nutrient. Are you following me? The blood carries the nutrient. It is a carrier. When waves dash across the shore, it is not the water causing the damage really, it's the energy moving through the water. You see the water, you can't see the energy. The blood is a carrier of the life, and so it is frequently used as a symbol of life. Now, let's go to Luke 22, let's read from verse 41. Luke 22, reading from verse 41, our subject, wonderful power. Let's take a look at blood. We need to understand what the Bible says. Do you have Luke 22, verse 41? This is Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says, and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared what? An angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. The next verse says, and being in an agony, he prayed the more earnestly. Finish that verse for me now. And his sweat was as it were what? Great drops of blood falling down. Jesus bled from his skin in Gethsemane. He shed blood in Gethsemane. Listen to me carefully. He shed blood in Gethsemane. Was that the payment for sin? If Christ had changed his mind and gone back to heaven from Gethsemane, would he have paid the price for sin? No. But did he shed blood? Yes. But did he give up his life in Gethsemane? No. Let me tell you something else about blood. Go to John 10. We have to understand blood symbolizes life. Because you can bleed and not die. And you can die and not bleed. Are you following me? Yes. I said that I'm confusing you. All right. Let's go to John 10, we read from verse 16. What happened when Jesus shed his blood? John 10, 16. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. 17. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, not lay down my blood. I lay down my life that I may take it again. Read 18 carefully. No man taketh it from me, but I lay down of myself. I have power to lay down. I have power to take it up again. This commandment have I received of my Father. Jesus said, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life. The blood symbolizes the life. We are saved by the life of Jesus. He gave up his life. You read Luke 23:46, and Jesus, when he cried with a loud voice, said to his Father, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. And having thus spoken, he gave up the ghost. He gave up the ghost. He gave up his life. Let me illustrate it this way. If you and I are in a car traveling on some highway, and we're hit by a truck, and I die. Did I die for you?
No.
But if I see you in the middle of the street and the truck is coming and I run out to get you and I get hit, did I die for you? Yes. Christ died for us. So he gave up his life. He wasn't just killed for us. He died for us. He gave up the life for us. Are you with me? He gave it up. That's why he tells us in John 10:17 or 18, no man taketh it from me. He gave up his life. But that life is righteousness. The life of Christ is a righteous life. And as we read in Romans 5:10, if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. It is the life of God, the life of Christ, that saves us. But the blood is a symbol, as a carrier of that life, symbolically. Jesus gave his life. His life is a righteous life. That's why Jeremiah 6:23 tells us, his name is the Lord, our righteousness. His very name is righteousness. He is righteousness. His life, righteousness, is a life. As verily as sin is a life, which has expressions. If someone has never given their life to Christ, and the person is in a coma, is the person still a sinner, yes or no? Yes. Does the person need Jesus?
Yes.
Is the person committing active acts of sin? No. Is the person a sinner? Yes. The life is a sinful life. Even though the person is in a coma, the life is a sinful life. And that person still needs a Savior. And the saving work of God is to exchange his life for ours. And so he gives us his righteous life, and he takes on him our sin. What does that mean? It's a terrible exchange. When I say terrible, it's painful for God. Go to Hebrews 1. Hebrews 1. Wonderful power. That power is the power to do right, and that power is righteousness. Hebrews 1, let's read verse 9 of Hebrews 1. 17 minutes to 8. This is God the Father speaking. What does he say? Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. God hates one thing. Tell me. Sin. And the very thing he hates, on Jesus Christ had to take. Not just on him. He took it in him. 1 Peter 1:24. Who his own self, 2:24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the cross. Jesus took unto him, and in him the thing he hates the most, he took it into him. Why? That he might give us his life. That life is the power to do what is right. That life is a righteous life. And so Paul says, I can do how many things? All things how? Through Christ, which strengtheneth me. And the strength of Christ is the very life of Christ. And the same Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The righteous life of Christ is expressed in me.
Amen.
As verily as the blood carries the life, so are we to be carriers of the life of Christ. Righteousness is the very life of Christ. Go to Romans chapter 6. Romans 6. I love to deal with this verse. I dealt with it in so many of my sermons. Very direct, very powerful. Romans 6. Let me pray as you look for it. Father, as I continue the downslope of this message, be with me still, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Wonderful power. The power of the life of Christ. The power of righteousness as opposed to the power of sin. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves, that's Romans 6:16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves, servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto or of
obedience
unto
righteousness.
Now let's pause there, take a deep breath. I said righteousness is life. Look at that verse again. We have two pairs of opposites. What are they?
Sin,
sin and death. Mm-hmm. What's the other pair? Obedience and? Okay. I need to know that all of you are focusing. Listen to the verse. Look at it while I say it. Know ye not? In other words, do you not know? That to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. In other words, life is a matter of obeying. The question is, whom shall I obey? You either obey God or you obey the devil. You have no choice other than that. You can choose whom, but you can choose not to obey. The Bible is clear. Every living being obeys either God, or Satan. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. Whether of sin, what does that lead to?
Death.
Or of?
Obedience.
Unto? Now look at those two pairs of opposites. Name the first pair.
Sin and?
Say it again. One more time. What's the other pair? Now, on the chalkboard of your mind, put sin, death, obedience, righteousness, or life, okay? Are you with me? Sin, death, obedience, life. What's the opposite of sin? Obedience. Ah, God bless you, my sister. I like you. Yes, the opposite of sin is whether sin unto death, obedience unto what?
Righteousness.
Now, the opposite of sin is obedience. What's the opposite of death based on those two?
Righteousness.
It's in the verse. Ah, you're looking at me and laughing at me. Now, let's try again. You have to see this. Whether of sin unto death, obedience unto righteousness. The opposite of sin in that verse is obedience. The opposite of death is righteousness, because righteousness is life. Doing right is a life. And the power to do right is doing right itself. You didn't hear what I said. Someone said, well, I can't keep the Sabbath. I said, no, you can. The power to keep the Sabbath is in keeping the Sabbath.
Amen.
Don't wait for power and then go keep it. It doesn't work like that. Start keeping it and you'll find the power is working. The power of obedience lies in obedience.
Amen.
Whether sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness, which is life. All through the Old Testament, you can find verses that talk about obedience is life. Go to Deuteronomy 8. Deuteronomy 8. Let's read from verse 1. Our subject, wonderful power, the power of righteousness, which is the life of Christ. Christ's life is righteousness. His kingdom is based on that. Deuteronomy 8 from verse 1. Read with me. What does that say? All the commandments, come on. which I command you this day shall ye observe to do, that ye may stop. What does observe to do? Give me one word for that. Obey. What's the outcome? That ye may live. Go to Romans 5. Read verse 19. Do you have that?
Amen.
Romans 5, verse 19. What does that verse say? Come on, tell me, what does that verse say?
For
as by one man's
disobedience,
come on, many will be sinners, so shall the by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. But go to verse 18, read verse 18. It says the same thing using different words. What does that verse say? Verse 18, wherefore?
As through one man's offense,
judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Come on.
Even
so, by the
righteousness,
the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. We have righteousness and offense in verse 18. We have obedience and disobedience in verse 19. They are saying the same thing. In verse 18, we have offense, which is sin, the opposite, righteousness. In verse 19, we have disobedience and obedience. So the offense in 18 is disobedience in 19. The righteousness in verse 18 is the obedience in 19. Righteousness is the life of Christ. It is the power to obey, as verily as sin is the power to disobey. The difference is we have to choose righteousness. But we're born hating God. Romans 8, verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. That's how we're born. For it is not subject to the law of God. It is not. The carnal mind cannot obey God to God's satisfaction. In the eyes of God, the carnal nature cannot obey. You know, people in prison comply, they don't obey. Are you with me? They comply because they don't want what? Punishment. A converted person obeys as an expression of love. People in penitentiaries comply. A converted person obeys as an expression of love. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness. Righteousness is life. Now, go back to Hebrews 1, let me close it off. Hebrews 1, let's read from verse 8. This is God the Father speaking to his Son, Jesus Christ. Hebrews 1, reading from verse 8. We're concluding, wonderful power, that power is the power to obey God, that power is the righteous life of Christ, which he gives as a gift. You can't earn it. Do you have Hebrews 1, verse 8?
Yes.
Thy throne, O God, this is the Father speaking, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Now, what does a scepter symbolize? What did I hear? Rulership, give me another word. Start with a P, then an O, then a W, then an E, then an R. How many of these clues do you need? Power. Are you with me? Power. The power of Christ's kingdom is righteousness. The scepter of thy kingdom, a scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Righteousness is the power that drives the kingdom of God. And so we read in Psalm 103, verse 20, speaking of the angels, bless the Lord, ye his angels, that do his will, hearkening, that obey his commandments, hearkening unto the voice of his word. The angels obey God. They keep his commandments. And the Bible says, all thy commandments are righteousness. Now go to Romans 8, let's close it off. Romans 8 from verse 1. Wonderful power, the power of a righteous life. And that life is the life of Christ. He lives it in us and through us. You cannot live that life separated from Christ. You can live a decent life, not a righteous life. Romans 8 from verse 1, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Where there's a law, there's obedience. Are you following me? You either obey the law of life or the law of sin. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Read verse 4 for me.
That
the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled where? In us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Christ came that that righteous life might be expressed in us. Christ came that through the outpouring of his life, you and I may be able to go back through Christ to the life God required of Adam.
Amen.
Before he sinned. This may boggle the mind, but God does not change his standards. Listen to me. God requires of us today the life he required of Adam before Adam sinned. And that life was a righteous life. And so the Bible says in Romans 5 verse 12, no need to go there. Wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world. Name that one man.
Jesus Christ.
No, wherefore as by one man, Adam, yeah, God will forgive you for your sins. Yeah, wherefore as by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. But what is sin? The transgression of the law. Then when Adam sinned, what did Adam do? Tell me quickly. He transgressed the law. And Christ came that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. And it's a gift. You see, Christ lived a life. Now he offers that life as a gift. Here's the life. Here's my hard drive. Put it in you. Start living my life. It's a gift. The carnal nature is an inheritance. The life of Christ is a gift.
Amen.
But we've got to believe in him with how much of our hearts? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy, not some. If you love God with 99% of your soul, to whom have you given the 1%? And that's all the enemy needs to destroy your life. Let me say this quickly. To save us, God needs 100% of the life. To destroy us, the devil only needs a little piece. I didn't say that clearly. You look beautifully confused. Let me say it again. To save us, God needs, tell me, 100% of the life given to me. To destroy us, the devil only needs a little piece. Ask God to grant you that gift of the righteous life of Christ. That is the power to conquer sin, the righteous life of Christ. And when you ask God for that, it is Christ himself in a mysterious way I cannot explain and will not try to explain. He lives it out from the inside out through the presence of his Holy Spirit. And so tonight, I ask God, Father, I surrender myself to you. Please, dear God, put that life of Christ within me, that I may have the power to obey. Not so much from the mind, but from the heart. How many will say with me genuinely, Father, give me that life of Christ. Can I see your hand? Do you mean that, yes or no?
Yes.
Stand up with me. Let me tell you with respect. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. What were they doing in the days of Noah? Did he eat? They drank. They married wives. They were given in marriage. That's what decent people do. Lost. Christ also said, likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot. Did he eat? They drank. They bought. They sold. They planted. They built. What are those things? What decent people do. They were lost. It is not a decent life that qualifies you or me for kingdom. It is the life of Christ in us. I told you a couple of nights ago, when in the Old Testament, when they brought a lamb to be sacrificed, the priest examined the lamb. Not the decent life of the person, the lamb. We need Christ. We have to be in him. So when the Father looks, he sees the life of Christ as our life. Jesus expresses this by saying, I am the tree, you are a branch. Whatever flows through me will go into you. It's the life. My life is the life that sustains you, the life of a righteous God. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Dear God, take what I said in my clumsy way, simplify it through the work of the Spirit, and apply it to those who heard, Father, in this building and online. It is such an important message. Righteousness is a powerful life. It is the power to live a life that pleases you, as verily a sin is the power to rebel against you. That sinful life we inherit, the righteous life we must receive as a gift when we request it. I pray, Father, that everyone who heard this message will develop a desire, a thirst for the righteous life of Christ, which is the power to obey. As we leave, let us reflect on what we've heard, dear God. Bless everyone who listened. Bring us back tomorrow to this place and online, wherever your people are, to listen to your word again, I pray. In Jesus' name, let God's people say, amen, amen and amen. You may be seated.